Good morning. Thank you so much, Kathy, for the generous introduction. I suppose that in the introduction, when Kathy said I was a fellow of the American Academy of Sciences, she meant fellow of the African Academy of Sciences, so just for the record. It's actually a pleasure to be here. I'm actually very excited and very thrilled to be here. And I'd like to thank the organizers of this meeting for the invitation. This has been a great opportunity for me, as well as my institution, as a representative of the African scientists, to make a presentation here this morning. Before I get into what I'm going to be talking about, as you can see over there, Rift Valley Fever in East Africa, Three Frontiers, One Purpose, I'd like to tell you what happened yesterday after we attended the Zika symposium. My colleagues and I had a debate. I wondered what is going to be the next emerging infectious disease that is going to be of global concern. So we just started naming diseases here and there. And one of my colleagues said it's going to be yellow fever. Another person said it's going to be chikungunya. And then I said chikungunya is actually already in the top public domain. It's actually in the Caribbean. It's a problem in Africa. And America is actually worried about it. So to contribute to this debate, I want to introduce you to this other one, which is also an arboviral disease, and it's an emerging infectious, a re-emerging infectious disease, and that is Rift Valley Fever. Now, what I'm going to do is to break this down to get you to follow me through. So I will discuss what Rift Valley Fever is, why East Africa is so important, what are these three frontiers, and what do we mean by one purpose. But before then, I think it's important, since we are an international audience, to get to know a little bit more about my institution and where this work actually has been carried out. And that is the International Center of Insect Physiology and Ecology. I've just prepared two slides to introduce you to the institution. So ICIPE, there it is, looks really very beautiful. And our focus is an African-based center of excellence. We are interested in food security and health. Now, how do we do that? We promote that using insects as a tool, because that's a problem within the African context when we talk about food security and health. Our headquarters is in Kenya, but we do have a country office, fairly large country office in Ethiopia. And we work in five main pillars. This is really very important because our target clients are the small-scale farmers, rural communities, and peri-urban communities. These are communities within Africa are usually marginalized. So when we are doing our research, it has to be holistic. We can't look at the health of the farmer or the crops the farmer grows without looking at it in total. It has to be a holistic thing. So we have to take care of the animals of the farmer, the environment in which the farmer lives in, the health of the farmer, as well as the crops grown by the farmer. Integrated within all these four pillars is capacity building. That's what falls into the fifth category. And our capacity building is not just engaging farmers. We also have a training program to train the highly skilled. And I'd like to say at this juncture that I'm a product of that capacity building program. I did my PhD at ICIPE. I'm a chemist. ICIPE transformed me into a chemical ecologist. So sometimes I masquerade as an entomologist. I'd like to say at this juncture that we do have a very strong delegation also from ICIPE because of the passion we have for the insect sciences. So, when you get the chance to meet an ICIPE person, please discuss all these problems that we work on. These are the areas we work in Africa. You can clearly see out there that we cover, with the five pillars, more than half of the continent, about 32 countries within Africa. But we operate from Kenya and then work with the national programs in these countries. Now, our portfolio covers basic research through all the way to the engagement with the community. It makes a lot of sense after all that basic research to interact with the communities that are affected. We have to share that information with them. And that is exactly what I'm going to do in this presentation. I'll bring out the basic research we've done on River Valley Fever and how, what we, the process that we went through to share with the communities that are affected by the problem. So ultimately, our work is to benefit Africans. The science we do is to benefit Africans. It does have a ripple effect globally, but our immediate focus is Africa. Why is science to benefit Africans so important? It all started with the vision of this man, the late Thomas Odhiambo. He was the founder director of ICIPE. It was his vision that only scientific research will bring Africa to a position where it can control its destiny. That vision and mission was strongly supported by the international community, including members, some members of the US National Academy of Sciences, other academies in Europe, and that led to the establishment of ICIPE. Now, that vision and mission has been maintained vigorously by successive leaders, Hans Hering, Christian Borgmaster, and obviously, we had to break the cycle somewhere. So we have our first woman director of ICIPE. I'm actually very excited to say that the immediate past director, Christian Borgmaster, and Segenet Kelemu are in the audience at the moment. So when you get the chance to visit Kenya, your projects in Kenya, please stop by at ICIPE. We are a center of excellence, not in isolation. We partner with a lot of institutions and would love to see you at ICIPE to discuss more how best we can collaborate. So now let's get to the real topic of the day, and that is Rift Valley Fever. Here are the facts about it. It's a zoonotic disease. Obviously, it can be passed on from an infected animal to humans. And that is why it's really very important that we should be talking about this disease in addition to Zika virus, or yellow fever, or dengue, which are all viruses, and zoonotic disease as well. So this has to be added to the debate because we don't know when it's going to be a big global problem. It's an RNA virus. It's one of the 160 RNA viruses that infect humans. And that is one of the reasons also that we have to be talking about it. The family is Wunjaviridae, and it's a flavovirus, totally different from the Zika virus, by the way. And the vectors are primarily mosquitoes. There are vaccines for livestock, but not humans. Now, if you understand or try a little to look at animal movements within the ecologies of Africa, even though the vaccine has been developed to last for 4 years, I can tell you that most probably within 2 years, animals lose their immunity because of the way animals are handled within the continent. So it means that we need something even more effective than what is out there. But the more important question or message here is that there's no vaccine for humans. So why three frontiers and one purpose? We can only define these when we look at the ecology of the virus, the cycle of the virus, then we will clearly understand why these three frontiers are important and what we call one purpose of prevention or early warning. Without that, it's not going to work. I got this from the CDC website. There are many versions of this, but this is brilliant, absolutely brilliant. So, to take you through this, it starts with dormant eggs that are already infected, mosquito eggs that are already infected with the virus, which means that these eggs are Transovarially, the female passes on the virus to the eggs. Now, this needs to be proven, but in reality, most of the time when you do have moderate rainfall and a little flooding, the dormant eggs that are already infected develop, and the adults that emerge are already infected. Now they have to look for a vertebrate host, and it's usually a livestock. Now, when they bite livestock, livestock amplifies the virus. You get more mosquitoes emerge, and when you have more rain or abnormal rain and abnormal flooding, more eggs develop, adults emerge that are infected, including uninfected ones, and they seek a host, and that is the vertebrate host. These amplify the virus. The infected, the uninfected mosquitoes pick up the virus from livestock hosts, and then you get lots of mosquitoes that are infected by other livestock, and that spreads the virus. And then eventually, because humans manage these livestock, they become incidental hosts. But when we look at the cycle, livestock are amplifiers of the virus, but humans actually are dead-end hosts of the virus. So that's how the cycle is transmitted. So there has to be really abnormal rain for unusual flooding to occur, and then you do get infected mosquitoes already, you know, emerging to find hosts and transmit the cycle. So to define the three frontiers, we clearly see that if we want to manage this or control this disease, we have to have the entomological or vector surveillance. This is very important. And we can't do that in isolation because of the virus cycle. We also have to have surveillance of the animal host for the virus. And at the same time, we have to do surveillance of the human host. The three have to go in hand. It cannot be just vector, about vector abundance and activity of vectors, what kind of species are involved, and so on. The three have to go in hand. And that is why that one health principle is very important. You got to have different disciplines working together to be able to control the disease. If the entomologists work alone without the involvement of the vets, as well as the medical personnel, the virologists, and so on, that is not going to go anywhere. And I think for quite a number of arboviral diseases, that is supposed to be the approach to take. And that's what we did at ICIPE. We had to take this kind of approach. Even though we are an insect science institution, we had to work with partners to be able to look into the problem of the RVF. So what are the symptoms, having said that, and then describe the cycles? We have an animal host. This is what the farmer would like to see. The pastoralist would like to see the animals healthy. But when Rift Valley fever virus strikes, obviously you're going to get fever. But more importantly, there will be abortions. And that is what wakes up the farmer, as well as the vet, and then sudden death in the animals. Now, in humans, it is mainly through contact with infected animals. Although mosquito bites can also contribute, but most of the time is due to contact of infected animals. And then contamination, milk that is contaminated or infected with the virus at the same time. People drink raw milk in that part of the world where there's this problem. So in humans, you do have fever that progressively generates into muscle pain, chronic joint pain, and then an eye disease. But most of the time, these things are subclinical until it's actually reached that case of chronic joint pain and ocular disease. But these two are life-threatening. This is the part that is worrying, and this is when patients actually end up in hospital. Encephalitis and hemorrhaging. That's the time when, within humans, they end up in hospitals. And by that time, 45% of those who are now suffering from this will die. So when I talk about Rift Valley fever, that we need to add it to the debate about what is potentially going to be an outbreak in the future, it is important that we add it to the debate. Now, the whole of Africa is at risk of this disease. But here is the history of it. In 1912, there was an outbreak in Kenya in a town called Naivasha. The characterization of the virus, again, was from an isolate from Naivasha. Virtually 20 years later, that's when the virus was characterized. And Naivasha is in the Rift Valley, the heart of the Rift Valley of Kenya. And that's why the virus is called Rift Valley fever virus, because of where it was actually isolated and characterized. So there you see Kenya. And in 1931, this was the situation in Kenya. Looking at Kenya today, this is the spread of the disease in Kenya. It covers virtually the whole country. And then the rest of Africa, there we can see it. With some outbreak for the first time recorded by 2011 in the Middle East, in Saudi Arabia and Yemen, in 2000 and 2010. So we can clearly see how the disease has been spreading between the last century and this century. And of course, from what I've just shown you, why do I have East Africa in my title? Because that's the epicenter of the disease. The epicenter of the disease is East Africa. And the most recent outbreak occurred in Uganda. This is the first time Uganda has been reporting the outbreak of the disease. So although East Africa is the epicenter of the disease, just look at this. The record goes to Kenya. Kenya has had almost a dozen major outbreaks of the disease. There are always minor outbreaks, but major outbreaks. So having said all this, it is only when we look at the burden of the disease in terms of economic terms that we can actually tell that this is something that we should be talking about. Over the years, about 200,000 animal deaths, human deaths about 2,000, which is just about a small percentage. But think about the cost, the public health, and as well as the economic cost. It's very difficult to quantify this all over Africa. But you can actually quantify this within an outbreak. Like in Kenya during the 2006-2007 outbreak, these are the costs. For a small country like Kenya, $45 million is a lot of money just for an outbreak and taking care of it, looking at total head of meat, milk loss, and so on. Now, this cost does not include the value of human lives and the ban on exports. So this is just an estimate. And for an African country, that's a lot of money. Now, talking about money, it means that we cannot devote all our resources on all the vectors. There are so many vectors of the virus. Like somebody yesterday was asking, that there are 63 vectors of the Zika virus. Where do you, put your emphasis? The same applies here. In Kenya, these are the two primary vectors. So in other words, if there are resources, the monitoring should be towards this. Because the last outbreak, about 70% of the infections were actually isolated from Aedes mackintoshi and Aedes ochreous. And these are known as the floodwater Aedes. Thank God Aedes aegypti is not one of these. Because actually vectors, dengue, Zika, yellow fever. So you can imagine if it's also vectors, Rift Valley fever. So these are the Aedes, floodwater Aedes. They are secondary vectors. Some more Aedes species as well as Culex species. But when it comes to concentrating resources, it's more important to focus on the two primary vectors that I talked about, Aedes mackintoshi and ochreous. So how is RVF predicted? I'm giving you all this background before I move on to our basic research so that you can actually understand why we did certain things. From the ecology of the virus, you can clearly tell that it's actually El Nino-driven, lots of rainfall. So this predictive model is actually based on abiotic factors climatic variables are mainly rainfall patterns, vegetation index anomalies. And it gives you a window of 3 months to prepare. But this is a macro model. When you come at the micro level, there are limitations to it, like regional and localized differences in environmental variables. And this is why ground truthing is very important. There are also in terms of specificity and lead time. Is it possible that we can have something that can allow us to predict RVF a lot earlier? In other words, during the inter-epidemic periods, do we have very good monitoring tools to be able to tell mosquito abundance? Do we have better diagnostic tools for us to be able to detect RVF in the animal host as well as humans? So now let's come to our basic research. The first frontier, which is the vector, entomological surveillance. What have we done as ICIPE, or our team at ICIPE, to contribute to in refining the surveillance of vectors? So we asked this question, can biotic factors be exploited for improved surveillance? Basically, what we are saying here is that what drives the vector-host interaction? And for me as a chemist, I like to be very structured. So you can't ask too many research questions. You have to have very few, but very focused. So under this, we try to address the question, can the host-seeking strategy of key vectors be exploited in surveillance during the inter-epidemic period? When it's an epidemic, you can just go out to the light trap and things like that. You catch all kinds of insects. But during the inter-epidemic, can we have a refined tool that will be able to tell us about not just mosquito numbers, but whether they are infected or not? And can the differential outbreak patterns be related to genetic differences of key vectors? I just mentioned that there are so many vectors of it, but the focus has to be on the key primary vectors. So that means that are there genetic differences within the country, if you take Kenya or Uganda and so on, so that we can concentrate resources on just those places by intensifying monitoring? So these are the two questions that I'm going to address very quickly. So let's take the first one. Can the host-seeking strategy of key vectors be exploited in surveillance? This is a typical host-seeking behavior of insects. The present trap that is out there relies heavily on the long-range attractant, that is carbon dioxide. That is a habitat location cue for mosquitoes and other blood-feeding insects. So if we look at this, what the CDC-like trap has done, or the CDC trap, is to develop that based on carbon dioxide, which is a long-range attractant, and visual cues. So here we are, that's the trap. The carbon dioxide is in that igloo, and then we have the light. If you use this to trap mosquitoes, this is what you get. You're going to get mosquitoes, you're going to get moths, you're going to get beetles, you're going to get some of the beetles who eat half the legs of the mosquitoes and so on. That sort of. So during an epidemic, it's fine. But you can't really rely on this during the inter-epidemic period. So just to illustrate this, you can clearly see these are the mosquitoes from this whole bunch that you've collected. And this is not effective during the inter-epidemic period. It needs to be refined. And that is the question that we asked ourselves, that can we now improve upon this by looking at the medium and short-range attractants? They make a big difference. I said carbon dioxide is a habitat location cue, but as an insect gets closer to the animal, other cues take over. And these are the short-range and medium-range cues. So to do this, we got a young scientist, David Chuasi, came as my PhD student. Very dynamic, very smart guy. And also to borrow some of the phrases from last night's debate, he has tremendous stamina. So we put David on this. And here we are, the sites that David had to work. We can't work without involving the Rift Valley area. That is where the virus was actually discovered. So one of it is this. This is the Rift Valley area. You see all these lakes? You can clearly tell the kind of mosquitoes that you're going to have over there. And then this is a different ecology, the northeastern part of Kenya. This is close to the Somali border. You can clearly see the difference in ecology. So this is a very dry area with a little forest over there called the Boni Forest, but really dry compared to these two areas. So if we come up with any lure, it should be able to work in these two areas. So David started off collecting odors from the animal skin and came up with all these various ways of collecting odors. Different bells with adsorbents on along the body of the insect, sorry, of the animal. You can actually see the donkey there, because the typical livestock head in Africa, particularly in East Africa, donkeys have components of it, and I'll tell you why, what they need them for. But the animals are very clever. You set up this, come back a few hours later, they found a branch or a shrub somewhere and pull this off. I mean, they rub it against it and eventually just falls apart. So it wasn't really very effective. We were collecting volatiles, they're all the same. So he actually came up with the idea that if you use a stock net and wrap the body of the animal for a few minutes, like 10 minutes or so on, and then now collect the odors from it, it works beautifully. So just with this stocking net, which is now loaded with odors, we attached it to the carbon dioxide igloo in a brass canister, which is right up there. And guess what? This traps only mosquitoes. Only mosquitoes. You don't get moths, you don't get beetles. That tells you how important chemistry is and chemical communication. The medium-range chemicals are so crucial to make a distinction. We didn't use the light. We just used carbon dioxide with the skin odors. Just mosquitoes. So here we are with some data. If we compare this to carbon dioxide, you use this odor from the cow, you can clearly see an increase in captures per night. Remember, this is the interepidemic period, really low density of mosquitoes, but you clearly see the sensitivity. Use that of a donkey, you get that. You get that of a goat, and also sheep. You find that this is virtually following the epidemiology of the disease. And he volunteered to put on clean socks to generate human odors overnight. So you see clearly the choices there, that even though we don't get any significant difference with the animal odors, they all look at that. The animal odors clearly stand out from carbon dioxide. So that told us we were on the verge of coming up with something. So these are the primary vectors. This is Aedes, McIntoshi, and Ocratius grouped together. The secondary vectors, here we are with Culex species. It works very well, but it's as good as carbon dioxide, because these ones are secondary vectors. They just respond to all kinds of odors. Mansonia species. Mansonia, particularly within the Rift Valley area, because this is a species that really you find around water bodies a lot. And there again, all of them work very well, but not very different from carbon dioxide. So you could just use carbon dioxide to collect these ones. But if you want to target the key primary vectors, you need the animal skin odors. We did some work with colleagues at the USDA, and there we decided to now test this using live animals. So we created pens, and had a net around it, opened up one space, and we did this in the Naivasha area. And you can clearly see how the cow odors, the live cow, does with the total mosquito catches. Doesn't only get uninfected, but then engorged. That is really very important. But what this means is that for a farmer with one or two cows, that farmer can treat the cow with mild insecticide, like pyrethrum, because this is a very important host for mosquitoes. So in terms of reducing mosquito numbers around the homestead, having one or two cows, if treat the cow with insecticide, that will be able to reduce and protect the farmer from getting an infection, not only from Rift Valley fever, but other viruses, or even malaria parasite. And it's actually being used in terms of malaria control. But we can also advocate this for those with small heads to do the same thing. Now, to get back to what is in the skin odors that actually make that difference, we did some electrophysiological studies, and what we do at ICIPE, we actually mount the whole insect, the whole live insect. Some laboratories use the antenna, some cut off the head, but we use the whole insect, and it works beautifully. The other additional advantage that we have doing this is that we use field-collected insects. We don't use lab-ready insects. We can use lab-ready insects, but we can always go to the field to collect insects. And they're actually more sensitive in detecting odors. You can't go wrong using field. It simulates the natural situation very well. So here we have the cow odors and the response from Aedes mackintoshi, key primary vector. The top part represents the chemical detection, which is the gas chromatograph, FID, flame ionization detection, and then the bottom part is the antenna of the insect. Donkey, goat, sheep, and then human. You see a pattern here, really nice pattern. And when we looked at the chemistry, they're very simple aldehydes. C7 to C10. There are other chemicals there, but this pattern was so unique that David decided to go out to the field to test individual components and establish their optimal attractive doses and blend them. And here we are, the individual components, these are the optimal attractive doses. Not really very good, the individual components, but this was the best for heptanol at this dose and so on. But when you combine the four, you get about 2.5 times more attraction to it. So it tells you how important the chemistry communication contributes to vector surveillance, and that needs to be built up. Now, so we came up with a tool that works, and it traps only mosquitoes, the key vectors of the disease, are highly attracted to it. But having collected all this, if we now want to intensify our monitoring of the key vectors, where do we focus? When you look at the map that I showed about Kenya, the spread of the disease all over the country, does it mean that we should be trapping everywhere or we'll concentrate our efforts in key areas? And we can only do that if we understand the population genetics of all these mosquitoes that we've trapped. And that's exactly what we did by targeting these two genes, COX-1 and ITS2. For Aedes mackintoshi, we ended up with four clades. The red one at the top was so unique, and that actually coincided, clade 4, with the outbreak pattern of the disease, where you do get frequency of the outbreak, which was the northeastern part of Kenya. This clade was unique to that. The others were distributed over Kenya. But if you look at Aedes or Cretaceous, it was uniform across the country, which means that the discovery that 70% of the infections during the 2006-2007 outbreak, that the focus should be on these two key vectors, really very important. But now we've shown here that there is potentially a species complex within Aedes mackintoshi. And clade 4, it's really key for us to monitor. But if you look at the divergence patterns, you see, truly, apart from clade 2 down there with the interaction with 1, which was below the threshold of 3, all of them were above that, proving and confirming that this comprises a species complex. But that's one part of the puzzle. We now need to demonstrate through vector competence studies that indeed clade 4 should be the one to focus on. In other words, if we can prove that in terms of vector competence studies, then we can actually intensify our sampling and monitoring in the northeastern part of the country. Or otherwise, if that's not the case, then it means we have to spread our resources and trap countrywide. Now, I can imagine that what is going through some of our minds is that, so where is the virus? After all this work, trapping, genetics, and so on. My two colleagues, Yandawe Vilinga and Rosemary San is a virologist, Yandawe is a molecular biologist, they've been spearheading this. And with all the tools that they've developed, using cultural techniques, and Yandawe using high-resolution, PCR high-resolution melting, basically this represents the melting curves of different viruses, including the Zika virus. There's so many viruses here. Yellow fever, chikungunya, Rift Valley fever, Zika virus, with all these techniques, and looking at 30,000, analyzing 30,000 mosquitoes, which we had trapped over the period, this is what we got. No RVM virus detection. What does this mean? Does it really mean that the infection levels were so low that we couldn't find this in any mosquito, not even a single mosquito? Or the tools we are using actually the wrong tools? And for me as a chemist, I thought that we can't leave it there. We have to ask ourselves, are we using the right tools or the wrong tools? So let me tell you why I feel that we need to continue refining this and not necessarily leave it there. So I started asking the question, what if we had tools that targeted older females, because older females would have fed, or engorged ones, the ones which are gravid and they are looking for a suitable oviposition site. So we decided to look at where the flooding occurs, which are called dambos. And again, David has been looking at this. Do cues from dambos play a role in the response of gravid RVF vectors? We've just started working there. And interestingly, here we are. When you take the water samples from the dambos and collect odors from them, and then you just subject that to the antenna of in the gas chromatography electrophysiological studies, you see, here we are, very strong detection of very tiny odors which come out from that. And detected not just only by Aedes macintoshi, but also Culex species. So that tells us that if we really can find what this is, and I love this as a chemist because that's really challenging. You hardly see anything, but the antenna responds very strongly. We are going to nail this because it is going to allow us to target older females as well as gravid. So this is one of the areas we're working in. We've not published that, but I thought I should share that with you. Then there are the areas we are supposed to touch, and we are looking at that. What is the degree of plant utilization in RVF vectors? Insects have to have a sugar source. And we can actually exploit that as well. So I had this PhD student, Vincent, really very smart student. Yesterday he made a presentation focusing on Aedes aegypti as a model in plant utilization and utilization of plant resources. But I'm going to just share a bit of the data he has for Rift Valley fever. So what we did was trap mosquitoes, determine the plant feeding status using cold anthrone tests. That would tell us that they've recently fed on sugar. And then the ones which were positive, anthrone positive, we extracted the plant DNA from the midgut of the mosquito, amplified and sequenced the extracted plant DNA to determine the host plant. Really cool stuff. Just watch this. Targeting this gene with all the mosquitoes we trapped, Aedes macintoshi and lucretius, these are the plants that we came across, Opuntia ficus indica. And then another plant, Nymphia sania. when we target this gene, we come across the same thing. So we were actually very lucky, because it doesn't work all the time for plant samples, but we were really lucky. We ended up with these hits. So we have two host plants here. We had to go and verify this in the field and also do the same kind of work. Here we are. This is Opuntia ficus. Really nice, bright colored flowers. It would be very interesting if we can raise Aedes macintoshi in the lab to look at survival studies. Can it really survive on this? But it's the most difficult thing to do. We can't raise these insects in the lab. So like Aedes aegypti, these are floodwater Aedes. So it's totally different in raising this. That's why we work with field insects. But as a chemist, the next question I asked was, do these key primary vectors detect odors from this plant? If they do, then we have something here. Watch this. We had to recruit this young lady who is an MSc student, because Vincent is winding up. And Julia has really very steady hands to do electrophysiology. Again, with field collected insects, clearly the bottom part is the antenna response to the odors which were collected from Opuntia. And this is very interesting. Just watch this. Look at the chemistry of the components detected from Opuntia. Remember the cow? There we are. See this? The overlap of chemicals. So it means that the primary vectors don't have to invest energy in looking for a sugar source. It's basically the same chemistry. But interestingly, we find there are some other components there, like the monoterpene there and the benzenoid. Can we exploit that? Can we add that to the recipe that we have or blend that we have to improve upon trap captures? Look at Nymphia cyanea. I decided to show you this photograph that this is a water lily. But what is more exciting about this is it's also a resource for bees. Our bees are still alive. We don't have a decline in bees. They use this also as a resource. So during the day, bees use this, but at night, mosquitoes actually use it as a resource. So again, and for a chemical ecologist, that would be a lot of questions that you can ask here with this kind of observation. Again, our primary vector, Aedes macintoshi, detects odors here. And if you look at that, really very tiny, for the very one which is very strong, that is a challenge for a chemist to detect. So that tells us that if we use this water lily, is it possible that this is a cue that is used by older females or gravid females to find a suitable suit? Or is it a combination of the odors from the water lily and then the odors from the water itself? I strongly believe that there has to be some microbes involved here. All this has to do with microbial origin. And we will nail this, eventually come up with a tool that works for gravid females. So here we are. When you go into the homesteads of these people, here is an example to show you. This is a typical homestead. Here are the animals. Look at what is there. That's Opuntia. So mosquitoes around here can get their blood meal. At the same time, they can get their sugar. And they don't need to fly too far away. And this is common all over the area. Opuntia everywhere. Opuntia. Different homesteads. It's all over the place. So we understand a lot more of the ecology in terms of when do we have to intervene, where do we put our resources. Here's the water lily, again, in the Dambo, doing very well. So when they fed, got the blood meal, they will find easily the oviposition site. And we need to confirm that with the odors from this. So the question is, we failed to get the virus in the vectors. What about Frontier 2? This was done hand in hand, and again at the same sites, looking at evidence of exposure. So we set up sentinel heads after 2006 and 7, using very young animals, because these ones are not exposed to the virus. between 12 to 15 months old. And if you monitor these over a time, collected baseline information on the IgG and IgN, that would give us some kind of information afterwards over a multi-year trial of 4 years. And in this area, you can clearly see this. You see that all this red? These are IgG prevalence, really mid level over here, in sheep and goat. So although we failed to find the virus in the vector, they're there. There is that exposure of sheep and goat at low levels over a period of time. So this is what I say. You can't work on vectors and only use abundance and activity to predict RV. You have to be looking at the animals as well. In the Ijaya area, again, very low exposure to the virus. And the thought process or the hypothesis is that most of the pastoralists move their big animals, cattle, into this forest during the dry season for pasture. And then on the onset of the rains, they come back to their villages. So the cattle that has been exposed to the virus in the village, in the forest now interact with the sheep and goats and so on, and mosquitoes now can pick up this. So this is a hypothesis which we need to test. The next thing is that, what about frontier three, that is virus surveillance in humans? Again, we did this at the same time. And clearly, you can see IgG prevalence of selected arboviruses by age, not only just RVF in humans. These are patients that appeared or ended up in hospital with febrile illness. So looking at the blood of these samples, of these patients, you find all these age ranges being exposed to the different types of viruses, including the RVF virus. So in terms of surveillance, we cannot simply just focus on one frontier or three. If we are just focused on mosquito vector, we would have missed out all this in terms of intensifying our surveillance. Now, after finding out all these, all that kind of results, what does it mean? Are scientists just publish papers and leave it there? No, we have to go back. The same people who allowed us to use their homesteads to collect mosquitoes, sample the animals of blood and humans, and so, we have to go back and share that information with them. And that is the philosophy of ICIPE. We can't just do basic science. We have to take it all the way and engage the community. And that's exactly what we did. We had to talk to policymakers, and the policymakers or local authorities now give us a permission. After sharing that information, then how can we package it and share it with the local community? Then you have to go and talk to the elders of the community. And then the next step is when they've gained your trust, they would exchange information with you. And here we are. They were telling us what they do with milk. They drink it raw. Here you have a case of helping an animal abort with their bare hands. I said, for humans, it's actually with contact of animals infected with disease. So these are some of their practices. If you understand their socioeconomic and cultural beliefs, then you can actually now, your findings, share it with them the appropriate way. So this is some data just to tell you what the community does. Drinking on boiled milk, use bare hands in, you know, helping aborted fetus. And they actually sleep with their livestock because the young ones have to be protected from wildlife, hyenas, and so on. So these are all ways of contact. But raw meat eating is very little. So having got this information, we had to run a training course, educate them so that they have actual ownership of the findings that we have. A training course, and you can actually see the enthusiasm. By the way, in communities like this, it's women who milk the cow or the goat. So you can't run a training course without involving women. And so you can actually see the enthusiasm. We teach them how to track mosquitoes and also how to identify the mosquitoes so that they can inform government or researchers what really is happening in their communities if we are not there. And like I said, our philosophy should be bottom up and not top down. So having given all these kind of training courses with the findings that we had,
We've got to understand one thing, and I want to show you this. This is really very important. Working in communities like this, the donkey is so important. Their livelihood is entirely dependent on that. So here we are as an example, carrying water, whether it's milk, going to the market. Look at the terrain. It's the donkey that can actually thrive in this kind of terrain. When they have to migrate because things are so bad, again, it's the donkey. You see beddings and everything is the donkey. So when you talk about mosquitoes, and they've learned about mosquitoes, and now have to give them bed nets to protect themselves against mosquito bites, against Rift Valley fever, against malaria, and so on. If you don't understand this and give them one bed net, you guess what? This is what is going to happen. They are going to protect the donkey with the bed net. So it means you have to give them several bed nets, not one, not two, but several. So they take care of their donkey, then the herdsman can now have one which he can actually protect himself in the field. Look at that herd of animals. In the field, then he can protect himself. So you have to understand these things, even if you have research findings, to understand clearly how to do it. So in summary, let's look at the three frontiers. What is the take-home message here? When we take vector surveillance, yes, we have a tool we developed that can accurately monitor vector abundance. It's only sensitive to mosquitoes. But that tool doesn't give us the virus that we are looking for. So we are looking at other ways of refining it, looking at reposition and plant feeding cues. That is under development. Under frontier two, which has to go hand in hand with the vector surveillance, we actually found viral activity in animal host. And the third one actually confirmed our philosophy of a One Health approach to do this. But having got all these three frontiers and that information, without community engagement, I think that we can only say to ourselves that we failed. But we involved the community. And today, with this project, the community, in terms of ownership, they own this. It's amazing how enthusiastic they are about this. Now, all that I've presented, all the papers that have been published, I've actually listed them out there. And this has involved several partners. You can actually see over there, ICIPE, we have the University of Bonn, Kenya Medical Research Institute, Division of Veterinary Services, Penn State University, we've been collaborating with other partners all over the world, including the USDA. David Scott is here with Lee. So we've worked together all over the world with various partners to be able to come up to this. But more importantly, you can't do this work without development partners. Google.org supported that generously, and all these other donors. But we cannot complete this without thanking the pastoralist communities in these affected areas that allowed us to do this research. Now, here we are. If you can't make it to Kenya because you don't have a project there, I think that there's still an opportunity for you to visit us at our website. Because I've told you who we are, what we do, and where you can find us. But if you can't, you can actually visit our website to see and learn more about the things that we do. Thank you.
Dr. Baldwyn, thank you very much for sharing such a passionate and insightful plenary lecture on Rift Valley fever in East Africa.
Thank you.